one day, this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
This fine church, we thank you for allowing us to come into your house of praise to worship our holy God. This is the Rock Church Fellowship International. Give it up. The pastor being Pastor Darryl and Tanya Houston. Come on, don't pity pat them. Give God here. God be the glory. Yeah, that was good. I like energy. Yeah. So I did introduce myself. They call me the Real Charlie B. I would be the MC for this evening. If y'all just be patient with me, sometimes I get happy and I get excited about God. So y'all be patient with your boy. But we'll go in the order that this program has been set. We will have a prayer by our first lady, Tanya Houston. I see.
Amen. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we just praise you.
Yes,
you're so awesome, God. You're so holy, God.
Yes.
Father God, we just thank you for what you've already done in our lives, yes. Father God, that we begin to put you first in every area, Father God. Now today, God, we would just lift your name on high. We're not necessarily going by program. We understand it is all about you, God.
Yes,
we thank you and praise you for what you're doing in this earth realm, Father God. We thank you that everything you're going to do is going to be done through relationships. So we choose today not to have hate in our heart, not to have bitterness toward our brothers and sisters, Father God. We thank you that you're moving in our lives, Father God. You're removing all lack, Father God. In the name of Jesus, we just thank you and praise you for what you're doing today. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Thank you, First Lady, for that wonderful prayer. We have a welcome from Prosperity. She looks familiar.
Thank you. Oh, praise God. How y'all doing? I'm Candace Blanks.
Amen.
Prosperity.
Amen. Amen.
And I just wanted to thank God just for now my husband and I, Reginald Blanks, the key to actually bring this program here to the Rock Church Fellowship International.
Amen.
Thank y'all for having us. God is truly awesome. This is our second annual Black History Program.
Amen.
And so when I asked God, I said, Lord, who do you want for me to have on this program? So everybody that actually came out agreed to be here, and God has placed everybody here, and I just thank God for y'all for coming out and showing out, and welcome to this great house of God.
Amen.
And we just like to just thank you all for coming and fellowshipping with us and just praising God and learning about Black history and what our ancestors have done for us to pave the way for us for today. And also, this was in honoring of our women, women of valor, you know, and so we're going to be actually just honoring the mothers who done paved the way for us and for me, myself. You know, unfortunately, my husband and my mom couldn't be here on today, but we just thank God other mothers and other women are here today celebrating with us. And true enough, we just like to welcome y'all, and I just want y'all to kick back. We all family. Y'all get to know somebody. And we just like to just welcome y'all here and enjoy the program. So God bless y'all.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Miss Candace Prosperity. This is Black History Program, so if my mother was here, she'd tell me to do it like this. I'm so glad, put your hands together. Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad. Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad. Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus lifted me. Oh, when I was in trouble.
Rise high as the listening. future has brought us, facing the rising skies, high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea.
Amen.
Y'all not standing up here. Stand up and give her a head clap. We're gonna root here, man. We're gonna root and we're gonna holler. Let's tell this roof up.
Amen.
That's what I believe. Okay. Looks like I'm on program.
Amen. Yeah.
Did you know into
Okay, actually, he's reading, did you know, that since we're doing the history of women, I decided to do intervals on the struggle first of what women had to go through of did you know. So what he read was, did you know that women suffered? They had a lot to endure. They couldn't vote. They couldn't do a lot of things back then. So it's did you know. Okay, here he stopped at, did you know the second wave feminist? In 1960 and 1970s, a new wave feminist arrived. When times to civil rights movements in the 1950s and the 1960s, the new women's movement took on a wider agenda than the women's suffrage movement had focused on. The mainstream to radicals, this feminist movement fought for equal rights and a new way of looking at gender use.
Yeah.
Also in the reproductive rights, did you know that reproductive rights address women's ability and the right to control when and whether a woman can be pregnant, whether the ability to control pregnancy during women's rights and other areas may be less meaningful, as women will not be able to fully make choices about their education, work, and marriage. In the 19th century in America, the birth rate fell. Why? Because the beginning of the century to the end, all around the world, the birth rate falls as women became better educated, having the economic opportunities, and here are some of the resources and other women's rights to the reproductive choices, including some of the women's keys to controversies. They had the Margaret Sanger. They had a lot of things went on during the reproductive time to cause the birth of kids to go down, like the Roe versus Wade, the abortion history, the clergy consolation service of abortion, Emma Goldman, Faye Walton. These are some of the women that doing that right. They fought for different things. And so during this time, during this interval, this is the struggle that women had to go through, dealing with equal rights, the right to vote, being able to work, and just basically the slave movement throughout history.
Yeah.
So, did you know that?
Thank God for a woman.
Yeah.
Thank God for a woman.
We gonna go.
My mama's a woman. A beautiful wife, she's a woman. I thank Candace for walking up and being a woman to me. Come on, let's give God a hand. I believe that we're up to the point. I believe that my friend, Midnight Storyteller, is here.
Amen.
Fairy.
Midnight Storyteller couldn't make it, so his sister's gone.
Gotcha.
Amen. Amen. Woo!
Searching for a heart that will love him.
Mike.
Yeah.
That was great. God bless you. Come on, give her a hand clap of praise. That was beautiful. Glory be to God. We'll go higher in this program.
I'm from Birmingham, Alabama. I've been in Houston for 30 years or more. But I was born and raised in Birmingham, Alabama. And a lot of people really get bits and pieces of their history, but I was born in a family environment which dealt with civil rights in the late 50s, early 60s. And I want to tell you that it was a real struggle because a lot of people don't understand how they got to be able to move around like they move around and really don't even take advantage of the rights that they have, or they're just plain just unsatisfied. So what I'm here today to tell you, I attended a church at a Bethel Baptist Church, Birmingham, Alabama, which is this church right here. And out of all the churches in Alabama, my church was bombed 3 times. And I want you to know my house was bombed 3 times. And my next door neighbor, some of you may know him and some of you might not, was Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth. You see him in this picture right here with Ralph Abernathy and Martin Luther King. And a lot of people really don't know that Birmingham broke the back of the South. They really don't know that. But I'm here to tell you, he was fighting civil rights way back. And he invited Martin Luther King there. He was fighting way back. A lot of things that people think somebody else did, they may be surprised to find out that he done a lot of these things. I'm not just building him up. It's just facts. He passed away about 2 years ago, and after the struggle, they still made him what they named the airport after. But I want you to know that he was jailed over 25, 30 times. He was beat. I also went to school at the place that he was beaten at. One of these pictures here. You probably seen clippings of him where they beat him. They integrate the school that I went to. That's him right down there getting beat. You probably seen flashes of this on television, but he was getting beat for the integration of the high school that I attended. Okay, and I want you to know, this is the house to where I lived at, and I was also in that house when it got bombed.
Wow.
So you can see, I was young, but I remember. When I walked out of the house, and I didn't walk out, the whole front of my house was caved in. What I'm here to tell you about is some of the things that went on. They had, I remember this right here when I was young, and I just remember when I came out, the porch was gone. The inside of our house was gone. I was just in the back. My sister carried scars on that. She's on one of these. That's why I say you have to look at this. Later. But I was raised there, and he actually started the Birmingham Christian Movement. Okay, I'm gonna slow down. I'm gonna start from one of these and just go across quick. That might be the best way to do this. My next door neighbor, this was his house. I think he got bombed here on Christmas Day. You see right there where he crawled out. Birmingham was a predominantly black area, one of the most prominent black areas in Birmingham. That's where they locked all of us up in there. And one of the first schools was started right there in Birmingham. They just closed us in. And Bull Connor, you probably heard of him in Alabama, but it was a constant struggle. I seen dogs beaten, they integrated the lunch counters, they spit on them, they marched. I seen them. I'm just talking personally. You know, I was downtown when they pulled out those little white tanks, what they call the National Guard out. And my family was, this house, the reason it got bombed so much, it was the guard house for the church. Okay, and this book right here, if you ever get a chance, Walk to Freedom, you'll notice that it was a lot of churches bombed, not just a couple. You know, the increases of the bombings was tremendous. I mean, because it was a lot of churches. They was targeting our church because I live right next door to him. He was my pastor. So when they bombed him, the church or the house. I think in this picture right here, this is my mother, because that was me a little later, but she also been awarded for discovering bombs on the side of the church, you know, where I was finna blow up. And that that bomb came, and a lot of people, only thing they remember is 16th Street bombing when the four people died, the four kids died. And that bombing right there, we knew them too. We was working in the movement. My whole family worked in the movement all the time, right on our porch. They planned everything. They planned when the school kids called a double D-Day up there. You just have to take a look at some of it. And that was a day when kids that was from 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, they all left school and they jail. Be pretty close to exact. But they jailed over 2,000 of those kids. Wow. Okay, and the bail was like $500 a piece. Wow. Now, this is back in the 60s. This was a lot of money. So they was hauling them to jail in buses, school buses. And they filled up all the jails. And they were playing this to where the kids was marching on City Hall at one point. And they was marching at another point or integrating the lunch counters. And the idea was to fill the jails up, which they did in Birmingham, Bessemer, to fill the jails up so they didn't have no room to put no more people. And it was all planned. You know, when they sit at the lunch counters, it was nonviolent. All this was nonviolent. So you go and you try to integrate the lunch counters or you try to get the bathrooms integrated. Because people just take for granted when they was getting food from the back doors or whatever. It's just a way of life. It's not a way of life. People got hurt for this way of life that we don't really respect. So what I'm saying here is they would come up and hawk on them, spit on them. And when we went to church, we didn't know whether we was going to get bombed or not. See how we sitting up in here all comfortable? When we went to church, we didn't know, it wasn't just, we was praising the Lord. We didn't know whether somebody was going to bomb our church or not. Bull Connor, they just sit right up. Soon as the bomb go off, predominantly black, there don't even be no cops in there. But when that bomb go off, they right there on the street within a minute. So it was planned. You know, a lot of things was planned. They're not just executed. I will tell you, even in the church, the God house, we definitely caught people trying to bomb. Some of them was beat to death up on the tracks. Some of them got away. I'm just saying, this is real life. This is what happened. When you see people getting attacked by dogs or you see people here, these are real people. You know, these are not just images. I was married in that church. This is 16th Street Baptist where the kids died. We ran a clean as we knew these people. So a lot of these things that I see this white tank right here, that's their little war wagon. You see where they folding arms there, you got King. You see where he be in jail, and when they put him in these cars under one of these, so many times that he went, they set a German Shepherd dog in there with him and shut the door. You know, and let him think about it. You understand? So what I'm saying, there's a lot of things that people really take for granted. How would you like to wake up on Christmas Day and your house get bombed up? You know, just everything he's doing. He integrated up in Selma, they march. There's a lot of things he did. I think a lot of people really just don't understand the struggle. Now, it was all done through the churches. A lot of times we don't get involved in things that's going on. We just talk about it. So people gave their life up to try to make things better. And a lot of these rights, they're trying to take them back from you because some of you don't really understand what you have. So quite naturally, if you don't think it's bothering your everyday life, you won't get out of your bed to do anything. Yes. So what I'm saying here today is the churches got involved. No, it wasn't always safe. They hung one guy in Birmingham right across from the city hall. They just opened the door to the jail and let him go. The cops just moved back and let him just go up and get him out of the jail, bring him down, and strung him up. They shot him over 200 times. They hung him and left him laying there, and then they set him afire. And this right across from the police station. So I left Birmingham because it really wasn't too much better
when I left. I experienced a lot of discrimination. I mean, I understand discrimination. I've seen riots in Miami, I've seen riots in Detroit, I've seen riots in Birmingham. I mean, it's still going on. So we got to get our heart right, get right with God, and understand that a lot of people died for these rights. A lot of people, we're losing a lot of rights that people are not paying attention to. I think you should start paying attention to what's going on, and remember, they'll take these rights back from you so quick. You'll still be going back in the back doors or whatever. There was a lot of people, white and black, that helped in this. There was a whole lot of people that gave their life for this. It wasn't just blacks, it was white and black. Some of them gave their life for this. So I just want people to be aware. And I'm not just saying Birmingham bombs out of now. They're setting bombs off with drugs, alcohol, and addiction.
Right.
Yeah.
Some of them fornication, some of them whatever, but they're bombing the kids' mind. Right. They're taking them out that way, and they're taking them out in larger numbers than the bombs.
Right.
So what I'm saying is right now, mind is still enslaved even though the rights have been given to us.
Right.
And it's moving through so frequently that it's just ridiculous. We get hit with HIV, we get hit. All of these things to me are systematically a way to take us out of here.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not, it even transformed because it transformed through money and it comes down to how much money you got and where you have to live. So it then surpassed color.
Yes.
It then got down to the point, like the Bible say, rich and poor almost to me. It's a discrimination against people who don't have. It's the ones who have and the ones who have not.
Yeah.
So this right here to me is a movement of the devil, and that's why the church have to be involved. We can sit back on it, but this is a thing where you see them praying and so forth. You have to take some type of action against people getting mistreated. You can no longer just sit in your comfortable house and act like you don't know what's going on. So they invited me here today. I appreciate all of these young ladies. But I want y'all to know that these kids, when you start reading here, they was 9 and 10 years old coming out of kindergarten in numbers of 3, 4, 5,000 leaving school. I'm talking about 9, 10 year old kids, high school kids, coming to diverse, march, and go to jail because they wanted to get involved. And so you're not too old to get involved and you're not too young. I just want you to understand these people wanted freedom. We need some things corrected today here. We're just acting like it, but discrimination is strong. I mean, real strong for us. That's why we're in the shape we're in. But I think it's a mental thing that we got to get past, and we definitely got to start helping one another because I see no unity a lot of time among the people. And I'm going to stop right here. I'll leave these posters.
Spiritual
She was the first woman to deliver the commencement address at Harvard University, the author of the best-selling book, My Life with Martin Luther King Jr. As you see, Ms. King did not allow fear to stop her. Fear was her motivation. She was determined to prove that black people can make an impact in our nation. I'm honored to speak on a woman who has strength, courage, and valor. A powerful, articulate, inspirational, spiritual Christian leader. Author, motivational, and public speaker. A black, smart, and beautiful wife and mother. She was truly a Proverbs 31 woman. Showing everyone this is the way. And with God, he won't lead us astray. And quote Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we free at last.
Amen.
Looking at Dr. Martin Luther King, an African American, saying his dream, black is beautiful. I look at Rosa Parks as she sits in front of the bus. Black is beautiful. I look at Sojourner Truth, who escaped slavery and preached for the rights of women. Black is beautiful. I look at Harriet Tubman as she led slaves through freedom. Black is what now?
Beautiful.
I look at Mahalia Jackson as she sings Negro spiritual. Black is
beautiful.
I look at black men and women and see that black is
beautiful.
I listen to Negro songs and codes and say that our ancestors endured a lot. Black is
beautiful.
God makes all colors, each and every one all the same, then we are all beautiful. We all struggle to conquer the diversities of this world. Black was just the color of the sheep in some societies. I'm glad now we can mix with different varieties. Black is not a separate color. We finally see what people fought and died to save. Now we know what they were trying to say when they said, being black is a beautiful thing, because black is
beautiful.
Just like me.
Thank you, Candace. It was, thank you, Pastor.
Amen.
And thank you, my wife, for coming with me.
Amen.
I didn't know what to talk about it as I was listening to Brother Williams and praise dances and God giving, putting the spirit in me. I am a regional director.
Mm-hmm.
I receive the benefits from those people too much in Mississippi and Alabama.
Wow.
I am one of those people that go to work 40 hours a day and deal with people with disabilities and deal with people that are in need. But I forget where and what got me there. You're talking about praising women. I forget my predecessor was a black woman. Was the first black to help my position. And she had it for 16 years. She paved the road for me. She went through all the hardships for me. You know, and I praise God for that.
Amen.
Yeah.
You know, as a regional director dealing with the state, I work for the state. We have 10 managers and 26 offices all over Houston and all over Texas. People come in our doors and they're looking for employment. And we help them. We help them move impediments. And then when we talk, when I came in here, Martin Luther King was speaking. And I was thinking, if it wasn't for him and people that walked with him and before him, mm-hmm. there would be no Rehab Act.
Mm-hmm.
In 1973, Congress passed the Rehab Act. And it is followed after the Civil Rights Act. It is about people being discriminated against. Only in the Rehab Act, it is people with disabilities.
So, you know, I was sitting there thinking, Black history. What am I talking about? I'm talking about arguing. I rode on the back of the bus. I remember those days. I talked to my wife about it sometimes. I lived in Virginia, in the country, and I would tell you right now, I'm not country. But I remember those. I remember that. I remember the insurance man coming to the door. And I think I was the only white man that ever came to our door. The insurance man. We have came a long way, but it's not done. It is not done. I was talking to some people yesterday about a plan that we have, a vision that we have. We have a vision of one more person in work. You know, there are 130-some counselors, and we have goals, and we're supposed to get these numbers. And to be successful, how many people? It's working. But we're thinking about, you know, changing the whole philosophy about numbers. No more, it's about one more person working. What can you do? When I ask one of my staff, or my counselors, or my managers, how many people you got working today? I don't know that. I don't know what you did today. What did you do today to help somebody else to go to work? Because see, the Department of Assistive and Rehab Services is one of the best kept secrets in the state. I mean, it'll come up some money there, y'all. And it's yours. Now, it's not entitlement, but if you got a disability, now, think about it. And I can ask any of you, I know you know somebody with a disability. Missing, and you, the major ones, missing a limb. Well, how about diabetes or depression or anxiety? How about ladies in school, learning disabilities, in a wheelchair? All those people to live normal in their community, they need some help. That's what me and my staff do. We find people in the community that will help them and pay for this or pay for that, and get them going so they can go to work. You know, you was talking about, man, you took me right there, Brother Williams, yeah, all those bitches, you really did. But you was talking about the bombs in the mines today, the alcoholics and the addicts and all the other stuff that goes around in the world. Part of my job is to deal with that stuff. But it shouldn't be just for when you walk in my door. It should be in places like this, and I thank you for it. Mm-hmm. I thank you for it. It should be talking to the pastors who have that influence in his neighborhood. How can I help you? That is my job. How can I help you get one more person? Because we can stop the bombs. We can stop the bombs in the mind. We can stop them. And a lot of times, y'all, I've had a disability, I've had that bomb in my mind too. You don't need to go in that, but it was there. God, you know, he said, hey. And he said, my wife one day, she prayed for me. Yeah. Yeah. She prayed for me. And she told me not to bring him into this, neither. If we walk this thing together and we build these partnerships, they'll tell them what we can do out there. They'll tell them what we can do. See, I work for an agency that you pay for it, your tax dollar. Imagine if you or your kids were driving down the highway and had an accident, traumatic brain injury or back injury. He could no longer go to work, or no longer live in his home comfortable. First thing you would get is a huge bill from the hospital. Mm-hmm. You would come to your church and you would pray. But there have to be action. And DARS is part of that action. We can come and we can do this or that. We can help you. But see, you don't know about that. You don't know about us. You don't know about But you may have a child, or your neighbor may have a child, and that child may have a learning disability, and you go to school and they put him in one of these programs. And he was in that program in the age of 6, and now he comes to guards in the 11th grade.
Yeah.
Trust in the Lord, God is so awesome. That's what I'm learning, to trust in Him each and every day, trust in the Lord. And then my wife is about to give some certificates to the woman, to the women.
Hallelujah. Okay. Again, we say that this program was for all the women who are here. And the way that I had the program was set up that I was going to do every category of age group for every woman who was here. But when I was sitting there, I was counting all the women in the audience. I'm like, I think I have enough for the women and the young women. And I say the young women because y'all gonna grow up into women. And y'all gonna allow, y'all gonna see that the women before y'all and your mothers and your grandmothers done instilled into y'all, y'all gonna start seeing the same attributes. And so I wanted to not only dedicate it to the older women, the wisdom, all these wisdom women out here, but also to the younger women who are in here as well. And I believe I have enough to go around. My husband designed a certificate for you, and this is what it says. The key to prosperity honors all women for their struggle, hard work, dedication, and sacrifice. Your labor is not in vain. We thank you. How We Made It Over, Black History Program, Saturday, February the 23rd, 2013. We appreciate you. Thank you. So if everyone can come up and get their certificate, my husband, I hand it to my husband, and we have a rose for you. And the rose, there's something significant about it. It's artificial, as you can see. Due to the fact that real roses die. We don't want our love to die for you, okay?
Hallelujah.